Right, so Mankandan, so welcome. So I have seen your resume actually. So I have gone through all the details you have put in your resume. So based on that, I have considered your profile as related to automation testing, mainly Java and Selenium Test NG. So I'll be asking some questions from Java, and then I'll ask some questions from Test NG and as well as Selenium. So I hope you have 2 years of experience, right? I can see in your resume. Okay, so before starting, so this let me give you some instructions. So basically, this video is going to be recorded, and later it will be uploaded in the YouTube. And your profile is shortlisted for automation interview, especially. So I'll be asking questions from only automation part. Okay, are you fine with that? So if you don't know the answer, so don't feel guilty. So you can ask me again. I can clarify your doubts and everything. Okay, so are you fine with that? Okay, shall we start?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. Okay, so first let us ask before asking questions from Java and automation. So can you just introduce yourself?
I am Manikandan, hailing
Okay.
from Tamil Nadu.
Okay.
I am a test engineer with about the experience of 2 years in Accenture Solutions Private Limited as an
Okay.
automation and manual tester. My area of expertise is testing web applications using Selenium automation tools, test automation frameworks, and automation frameworks like TestNG. I also got involved in the manual testing of the web applications. I quit my job in 2019 due to some medical issues.
Okay.
And I have also, in the past, I have involved myself in some freelancing services.
Okay.
Now I'm ready to get into some working environment. Actually, by next week, I will be attending an interview from at an IT solution company.
Okay.
So, my strengths are I'm a hard worker, quick learner, and a critical thinker.
Okay.
My weakness is overthinking. My hobbies are listening to music and reading magazines.
Okay.
Furthermore, you can view
Okay.
in my resume, sir. Thanks
Okay.
for the opportunity.
Yeah, that's fine. So whenever introducing yourself, just mainly focus on your experience and
Okay,
your
sir.
skills on your project. Okay, you don't need to tell
Okay.
your hobbies and the strengths and minus plus, all these things you don't need to explain in during interview. Okay, so just
Okay,
mainly
sir.
focus on your experience and your roles, responsibilities on your project, what you have done and what technologies you learned. So they are main important things. Okay. Yeah, so let me ask some questions from Java. So what do you know about inheritance?
Inheritance something, class or a method can be inherited to a super class, subclass can be inherited
Okay.
from one package to another or in the same package.
Okay,
It's
so
a
what is
part
the
of the books.
what is the use of inheritance? What is the use?
Inheritance helps us to actually just tell me, sir.
Yeah, no problem. So inheritance is a one of the object-oriented programming concept. So when I use inheritance, what is the benefit you will get?
Can
So why?
inherit the data.
Yeah. So why we need to
Actually,
ex yeah. Yes.
in a from a subclass, we can extend the value to the superclass. Like in case if I take a Selenium concept, when I'm using a Chrome browser, I used to open the Chrome browser using the normal properties. And when I have to extend this class to some other, like opening the new modules like logins or some e-commerce websites, I will be going to the extends class. This is it, so that I can extend the superclass to the some subclasses.
Okay,
So
so
it
okay,
helps
you are
to build.
extending it, but what is the benefit of extending that superclass into subclass?
It helps us to say the code looks somewhat easier to understand. At the same time, it help us to reusable also.
Okay, so what is exact benefit actually? You mentioned something or you specified some methods variable in the superclass. And you are extending the class into subclass, right? Why you are extending? What is the benefit you will get when you extend in this class?
Maybe I can change the variables also in the subclasses. Variables are methods values in subclasses.
Okay. So what about the reusability? So the main purpose of
Yeah.
inheritance is a reusable, right?
Reusable.
Reusability, right? So
Yes.
whatever methods or
Reusable.
variables you created in the superclass, instead of creating them in the subclass again, so you just extend the class into
Extended.
subclass and again you continue with the subclass. So the main
Yes, sir.
purpose of inheritance is reusability, to achieve the reusability
Exactly.
we used inheritance. Okay.
Exactly.
So when do you use static keyword in
Static
Java?
keyword in order to keep the variable particular to the class at the class level.
Okay, what is the purpose of using static?
It's an access modifier in order to keep the variable particular to the class level so that we can extend the variable to.
Can you repeat again? I think your voice is not clear yet. Can you repeat one
since
second?
If we use the static variable, static keyword for the variable or a method or a class, for not a class, for nested class,
okay,
we can init the variable within the class. So it's a class level keyword.
Is there any other usage?
I can declare the value for this final case of when the
I'm asking about only static, don't go for final and all. I'm just asking for the static keyword. So what is the use of static keyword? Where do you use the static keyword? Suppose I create a variable as a static, what is the purpose of creating the static? Why you want to define the variable as a static?
So the variable is going to, like I say, I can give an example. If there's a student studying a school, there will be a different name for students and different roll numbers, but the school name is going to be the same. So in order to define that variable, we can give it a static. It will be common for the entire method or the subclasses even.
Exactly.
So that's why we use static.
Yeah. If there is any method or variable, the values are common across multiple objects, we can define as a static variable, right? And those variables or methods we can access directly through the class name itself without creating any object. That's the main purpose of using static keyword. Can you tell me about access modifiers in Java?
Access modifiers, public, public, private, default and protected. Public is do you want to explain that?
Yeah, tell me.
Public is something which is accessible all the like access to the whole world of Java, so it is like can access in any package. Private is particular to that particular class, while protected is something particular to the package and to the another package which can be used by extension, inheritance, in case of protected. For default modifier, we can use it for the same package only, not for the other package, can be extended.
Okay, so basically public, protected, private and default.
Default.
So is that is it really required to specify the default access modifier for the variables or methods?
So actually compiler will take automatically. You don't want to specify it.
Okay. So let us say I have a class and I created one a method. I have not specified any access modifier for that method. So what will be considered? How it will consider? So which access modifier by default it will consider?
To take default.
Okay. So for example, let's say I created an interface. In interface, I created a method. Let's say an abstract method or whatever. So what is an access modifier by default it will consider?
Public.
What is that?
Public.
Public. Okay.
In interface, yes.
Yeah. So in interface, by default, the methods are public. Okay, great. So in Java, let's say, we work with some exceptions, right? So why we need to handle the exceptions?
We have to go on with the code. So the exceptions will be handled in order to continue with the code, or else it will make sure that the code gets stopped.
Can you just repeat once again? Your voice is not clear.
If you are not going to handle the exceptions properly,
okay,
the code may not execute properly. It will be ended up abruptly in the middle. So we can't continue the test scripts.
Okay, so like you are saying, if there is an exception, it throws some it throws some exception. Yes. So if I don't handle that exception, the rest of the code will not be continued, right? So if you want to continue with the rest of the code, we need to handle that exception and we go with the So how do you handle that exception?
Using try catch method.
Okay. So that suppose
there are two types of exception, like checked and unchecked.
Okay.
So
let me ask the question. Like, suppose let us say I have a statement in Java program, so that is throwing some exception, and I know it is throwing some exception, and I should handle that.
Okay.
But I don't know what kind of exception that statement may throw. Right? I don't know that exception. So in that case, how we can handle that exception? You know, definitely that statement may throw some exception, but you don't know exactly what kind of exception it will throw at the runtime. So how we can handle that exception?
Okay, try it, sir. I'm not sure that I'm going to tell, but I'll try it.
Okay.
So I will try that. I'll put try class there and open a curly brace. Inside that, okay. I will give which element statement is going to give an error.
Okay.
And with and next case catch, where okay. I will give the exception name.
Okay.
Not the exception, normal exception, and I will give a variable and e dot print stack trace maybe.
Okay.
When I use this, it will catch the exception.
Okay. Okay, so basically if you don't know the what kind of exception it will throw, normally we'll say the exception class in the try, block, you yes. can say just only exception and that will be able to handle it.
Yes.
Okay, so can you write a program? So if you have a notepad or you can just take it and you can also share your screen. Possibly you can share your screen. Okay, so the program is, let us say I have a string. Which contains, let's say, you can take the string, let's say string s equal to, in the double quotations, you can take some of the strings. You can just write your program, string str sum equal to, in the double quotations, you have something called Java, comma, Java, and comma, Selenium, comma, testng, and comma, maven, comma Jenkins. So these are the different words we have in this particular string. Okay, now I want to split the string into multiple words. I want to read that data individual, like Java, Selenium, testng, maven. So I want to read four different words from the string. Basically I want to split that into multiple parts. So how we can write a program?
I can use the keyword split so that you split the value by the delimiter the comma.
So I can just write a program and once you write and then explain.
When I use this comment, it automatically will split based on the comment delimiter value. Do we need to write entire things like system.output? So can you hear me?
Yeah. Yeah, please complete that program.
Okay.
So what is an output you will get if you run this program? What is an output you will get?
It will be Java, Selenium, or testng.
No, when you say split method, you said just comma. Is it correct? First of all, syntactically, is it correct statement? Second line S1 dot split. Is that correct?
I'm splitting this variable, this string.
Okay. S1 dot split of, you simply say only comma. Is that correct? Syntactically correct or not?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so in the split method, basically, you are using a delimiter, right? That comma is a delimiter. So based on the delimiter. You want to split the data. So that should be kept in the double quotation. You need to keep that in the double quotation.
Sorry. I'm sorry, sir.
Yeah. So that is the one syntax error. Okay. So let's say you have done like this. And what is the split method will return? What is the return type? What is the split method will return?
Return a string.
No, I just want to I just want to get the different type of multiple values. Let's say Java, Selenium, testng, maven. I want to print them differently. So will this work? S1 dot split comma, you split the data into multiple parts. Okay. After splitting them, you put them again in the string variable. Is that correct or not? You specify another variable called string str equal to. Is that correct or not?
Yes, correct, sir.
Sure, are you sure?
Maybe not to print line by line, I have to give a for loop. Or else.
No, first of all, just look at the second statement. Are you sure the second statement is correct or not?
Yes.
Split method. What split method will return? A string or something else? Have you ever tried this?
Yes, sir. I have done anything.
So what is the split method? What is the return type of split method?
character.
What is the return type of split method?
It's string, I think.
Not a string. A split method will return the array, right? Array type. So here you split that entire string into based on the comma. So how many values it will return? So how many words we have? 3, 4, right? So the split method return 4 values, and all of them are string type. So string str is a array type of variable. It should be array type. Str is a array type of variable. And once you get those data into array variable, then you have to write a loop statement, which will read individual value one by one.
Okay.
Got my point? So split method will not return a string. Split method will return array. After splitting, you have a multiple values, right? So if it return multiple values, where you can store multiple values, you have to create a array type of variable. So only array type of variable can store multiple values. So once you get those values into array, then you have to write a loop statement, and then you can continue printing those values. Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Let me ask you another simple program. So I have 3 strings. You can create one more variable. So you can just remove this one. Yeah. So now let's say str, a string variable. So string str1 equal to, let's say, ABC, and the string str equal to XYG, and the string str1, yeah, str2, yeah, string str2 equal to some XYZ, and string str3 equal to string str3 equal to some other character, let's say PQR. Okay, string str3 equal to PQR. So now my requirement is I want to concatenate these 3 strings. I want to combine these 3 and print as a single string. So how we can concatenate?
Strings are immutable.
So how we can concatenate all 3 strings and how we print that output? Can you just write a program? Okay, so is it correct? Are you sure?
I think so. Yes.
Okay, so do you know about a concat method in Java?
Yeah,
I know about concat method.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so by using concat method, how we can join those 3 strings?
I can just use a plus symbol.
Okay, plus is okay. So if you can concatenate by using plus, but other than plus, I don't want to use plus. Because they are strings. So can you write the statement how we can concatenate 3 strings using concat method?
Thank you. Yes, two will return the value of n.
So is that correct? Str1 dot concatenate s2, str2. So you're concatenating str1 and str2. Again, is you're storing in s1.
S1, yes.
Okay, and again, taking s1 dot concatenate str3. So again, you're concatenating s2. So the logically it is correct, but syntactically it is not correct because s1, s2. Okay, so str1 you have taken, str2 are passing s1, s2. Okay, yeah. Okay, so we can write a single statement, right? So how we can write a single statement instead of creating a two different variables, s1 and s2. I don't want to create another two variables. So within single statement, I should be able to concatenate all three strings. How we can do it? I don't want to use s1 and s2, a different two different variables. So take only str1, str2, str3 and just concatenate.
Sorry about this, but
will it work? Is it correct?
Think so.
Okay. Sure. Can you pass two parameters in concat method?
No, actually it's no.
Yeah. So actually concat method will take only one parameter, str1 dot concatenate str2. So that will combine two strings. So after that, you need to write one more concat method. Okay. So you need to write one more concat method. You can just remove str3, the second parameter. Okay. So this will concat only first two strings. Again, dot concat of, then again one more string, str3. So now if I use this complete expression in the print statement, and that will print the concatenated string. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So now let me ask some questions from Selenium. So we can stop sharing screen now. Okay. All right. Okay. So let me ask some questions from Selenium. So what is the rating can you give? Let's say 1 to 10. How much rating can you give yourself in automation?
Plus Selenium.
Yeah.
Yes, I can give 9.
So 1 to 10. How much rating can you give yourself?
9, sir.
9. Okay, great. So let me ask some questions. Okay, so you mentioned your project in your resume, like you have done a few things in automation. So can you just tell me what is your role, what is your role in your automation? So what exactly you do in automation on day-to-day basis
in my project?
Yes,
actually we test a site which is going to be containing different elements in it, like frames. So you have to automate everything, like from login to, because I have automated only on case of the users, adding the users to the, as I mentioned in the Selenium activities in project one, I will be adding the users and mapping them to their projects and to the customers. So I do it that way.
Okay.
What do you expect, sir? What do you want to elaborate?
Okay. So no, in the really in automation, so what exactly you have done in automation? Like, have you written only scripts, or have you involved in the framework, or what is your contribution towards your automation?
As I mentioned, I'm involved in framework also.
Okay.
Framework like hybrid framework and POM, like page object model, and I'm involved in it also.
Okay. Okay. Let me ask some questions then. So let us say you have 100 test cases. Okay. Let's say 100 manual test cases are there. So you want to exclude some test cases. You will not automate 100 test cases every time. So you want to exclude some test cases for automation. Okay. So on how, what are the test cases you will exclude?
How I do, or what are the?
So let's say you have given 100 test cases are there, okay? 100, among 100 test cases. So you want to automate some test cases. Okay, I'm not asking like what are the test cases you will automate. I'm not asking that. So let us say you have 100 test cases, and you will not automate all 100 test cases. Let us say there are some test cases you have to exclude, right?
Okay.
So what are the test cases you will exclude for automation?
I will go for groups. Yeah, take the help of TestNG. I will make a groups which I'm going to.
No. I'm not asking TestNG groups, all these things. Just leave it aside. I'm just asking you have 100 test cases, and you have to choose some test cases for automation, right? So let's say 100 test cases. Let me complete the question. So let's say 100 test cases. And you have chosen 90 test cases for automation. Let us assume 90 test cases for automation, 10 test cases you have not chosen for automation. So on what basis you have excluded those 10 test cases?
Those cases may be not repetitive. Repetitive are they are going to be fit for the automation. Maybe they are failing or they are not reproducible in the case of the automation or difficult to do it. Maybe complexity may come into picture. Actually, first priority I will go for the they are not repetitive, repetitive things to be happening, or the priority is not much important to get automated, or the regression is not needed for that case, set test cases. So that based on this thing, I will eliminate this case, exclude those cases.
Okay. So for example, let's say I have few test cases, you have not executed them manually. Okay. They are not executed manually. So do you automate those test cases or not?
Actually, no, sir.
Okay.
You can't directly get into automation. That may cause some errors.
Okay. So that means at least you have to execute one time manually and they should pass, right? Once the application or test case is stable, and then you will choose that test case for automation, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. And so in Selenium, so what are the different locators are supported?
There are 8 locators, like ID, name, class name, tag name, link text, partial link text, XPath, CSS selector.
Okay, great. So what is the difference between XPath and CSS?
XPath is something based on XML document. So it's follows the top-down approach. It can even pass from the parent to child or from the child to parent. But CSS selector is only top to down. It cannot get back from down to top. So XPath is based on XML document. CSS selector is based on something, use the tag names or IDs, get use of IDs.
Okay, so basically you're saying XML is basically we can navigate, right? Or we can traverse to top to bottom and bottom to top.
But in
CSS, we will able to traverse only through top to bottom. We cannot go to the reverse way. Yeah, perfect.
Yes, sir.
Perfect. Okay, so what is the difference between get text and get attribute of value? There are
get
two
text
methods.
Actually, get text actually get the values from the text box. We have, if we enter a value in a first name or last name something, it will get the value of the text. But get attribute is something, it get the value of attributes using in the constructor. Like if you give the value as href or anchor tag, or the name or value, it will bring the value of that particular attribute.
Okay. So for example, let's say I have used get text methods for link or some label or some other element other than text box. So what this will return?
It will return error. It won't pick up. It will show nothing.
Are you sure?
We have to use.
Are you sure? So let's say I have used get text method for link. So identify link dot get text method. So what that will return?
Sorry, it will return.
What that will return?
It will return the value.
What is that value?
You are asking for the link text or something.
Okay, so in that case, can we use get attribute of value?
I can use href if there is a href value.
Okay, so do you know something like a inner text?
Yes, sir.
So
inner text element between the anchor tags.
Yeah, so get text method basically return the inner text of the element. So it's not only for input or text box, we can use get text method for all kinds of elements.
So,
but if there is any inner text is attached to that element, so the text will be written by the get text method. But whereas get attribute of value, so which will capture the value of any attribute.
Attributes.
Right. So if you want to capture the attribute of any value, or any value of the attribute, then we can go with the get attribute of method. Okay, so in automation, let's say when do you use wait statements? What is the use of a wait statement? When exactly it is required?
Actually, when the element is not getting displayed or the browser takes some time to load, we use wait statement. Automatically, web driver has its own wait for some times.
Mm-hmm.
But if the element is not going to display it properly at that time also, we are going to use some like thread.sleep or implicit wait or implicit wait based on the conditions.
Okay, so do you know any term like this? What is the problem? Let's say you're saying like if the page is loading slowly, or suppose the elements are loading slowly. So at that time you're saying like wait statements we need. Like, what is that technical term used? What is that problem?
I don't get it, sir. What's the technical
What
term?
is that? So let's say my application is responding very slowly, but my automation script is very faster, right, in execution. So there will be some syncing problem, right?
Yes.
So what is that? Synchronization. So have you heard about these terms sometimes?
Yes, yes.
Synchronization. Yeah, this is synchronization. Yeah. To solve the synchronization problem, so normally we use a wait statement. So
yes, okay.
Normally when the synchronization problem occurs, your application is very slowly responding, but at the time your automation script is going to execute very faster, and some elements are not available by the time your script is executing, right? So in those situations, so you will see the synchronization problem. So to avoid that, you use wait statements.
Yes, okay.
All right, great. So do you know about desired capabilities? So what is the desired capabilities in automation? So where do you use it?
Actually, we use it for in case of Selenium grid. I have noticed in Selenium grid concepts.
Okay.
In order to set up the web driver, I used it. Desired capabilities.
What do you specify in the desired capabilities?
I'll specify the first I'll initialize an object. Then okay. I'll specify the windows. Platform and the browser. I'll specify those values.
Yeah, basically you need capabilities to specify the configuration, browser like script. Browser version, browser name, operating system version number. So if you want to specify all these kind of configurations, you need to specify the desired capabilities.
Yes,
okay, so that's the use of desired capabilities. And in which format you specify desired capabilities? Is there any format we need to specify, or how we can specify those capabilities? Desired capabilities, in which format of data which will accept and desired capabilities?
Format of data, maybe in string or something you're asking.
Let's say you want to specify Chrome version, right? Mm-hmm. So let's say you have a browser name is Chrome, the version number is some 65.5 something. So how we can specify that in a desired capabilities method?
I just name the value as browser.
Okay, what else? Basically, which will accept the key and value pair, right? Version is some version number, browser name of the browser, OS, what is the OS name? So key and value pair. So basically, desired capabilities will take the data in the form of key and value pairs.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so while you're automating your test script or execution, so do you see any exceptions? Can you just tell me some exceptions? What kind of exceptions you got?
Element not intractable exceptions.
Okay.
No such element exception. No such alert. No alert present exception. No
okay.
Frames. And Java null pointer exception you have faced. WebDriver exceptions.
Okay. Okay, when do you get stale element exception?
In a scenario when a locator element through the locator, mm-hmm. after when the page get refreshed, the element become old, so it will become yeah. stale. So I can't okay. identify those elements, so it will throw in a stale element exception.
Okay, great. Yeah. So what is the use of JavaScript executor in Selenium?
It can find the hidden values, hidden elements in the browsing page, websites. Mm-hmm. Also, we can use it for the scrolling, scroll to the particular element or scroll to the particular element to be clicked. So in this case, we can use JavaScript executor.
Okay, so JavaScript executor, basically we can use for any type of operations. Okay, normally mm-hmm. we use click method, send key, scrolling.
Yes.
So basically the usage of JavaScript executor is we can execute our JavaScript through Selenium. Right.
Yes.
So you can do almost all kinds of activities by using JavaScript executor, not only click and everything, scrolling. So you can do a lot mm-hmm. of other things.
Okay.
So let's say I have a drop down, and how to find number of options present in the drop down. Let's say I have 100 countries are there. So I just want to find total number of elements in the drop down. How we can find?
First, I would get into the element. I'll go for the list web element is equal to driver dot find element.
Can you write a code if possible? Just let us take some drop down and just try to find out how many options are there. You can share your
real time, sir. I would use a browser.
Yeah, you can. Yeah, you can just no. You can just take the notepad and just write it 2 to 3 statements. You can share your screen. Okay. Now we can just write an automation script. So let us have any drop down is there. So you need to just find out the options, the number of options present in the drop down. You don't need to use exactly for loop. Without for loop, you can still do it actually.
Yes.
So let's say you have a drop down. Yeah. So no problem. So let's say you have a drop down. So there are multiple options are there. So you need to write a one common XPath which will able to find all the options in the drop down.
Okay.
And you can use find element and then you can specify that XPath that will return all the options in the form of web element. So then you can store them in the list of web element variable. And you can simply size once you get all the options in the form of web elements in the variable, you can simply use size method, right? In the list collection, we have a method called size. So by using size method, you can find out. Okay, suppose if you don't have a select tag, let's say assume that there's not a select type of drop down. Okay, in that case, that approach is works. But suppose if you have a select drop down, there is a drop down. So for that, select tag is there in HTML. So this is a normal drop down, right? So in that case, how we can handle?
For handling the drop down, I have to get the size.
So no, just want to get the size. First we need to capture the drop down into select class.
Yes.
So then we can use the get options. Do you know that do you know about that method? Get options.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, get options is a method which will return all the options in the form of web elements. And those options also we can store in the list of web element. Okay, so in that case, you can use once we get all the elements in the form of list collection, so we can find you can use it size method and we can find number of options. Okay, so like, yeah, so that's fine. You can just stop. In your resume, I can see you worked on like Apache PUI, that is API. So can you just tell me some methods? What are the methods you have used from Apache PUI in your automation?
like
Yeah.
copy file.
Let's say you do some kind of operations, right? Just you need
On
to
Excel,
open the
yes.
Excel file and you need to get the sheet, get the workbook, get the sheet, find out the rows, find out the
Find
cells. So what are the different methods you have used to perform these operations on Excel?
I was the get sheet value, get sheet at
okay.
Get rows,
Okay.
get columns, get cell, sorry, cell, get cell.
Okay.
Gets cell string value, get cell string
okay.
value.
Okay. Okay, great.
So
yeah, that's fine. That's fine.
Cell contents.
All right. So let me ask some questions from TestNG. Okay. So can you just tell me what are the main features you have used in your project from TestNG? Just tell me just two or three features. Just tell me two or three important features which you have used in your framework from TestNG.
Priorities.
Okay.
Depends on methods.
Okay.
And data provider. Data provider.
Okay.
And
okay.
Parameters.
Okay. Okay. Fine. And have you used parallel testing?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Fine.
That's right.
Okay. So let's say in my TestNG, so I have multiple test methods are created. Let's say I have 10 test methods are created. So I want to execute them in proper order. In which order the test methods will execute? Let's say I have created 10 test methods. In which order the test methods will execute?
Based on the priority. If I give priority, it will go in order. Or else it will take the alphabetical order.
Okay. So by default, it will go as an alphabetical order. So if you specify the priority, based on the priority, it will go. Okay. Okay.
Yep.
Okay, so let us say I have two methods created and one method I have not provided any priority and one method I given priority as a one. So in which order the test methods will execute?
The one with the first will be the method without priority and the priority
okay.
one.
Okay.
Because the priority starts with zero.
Okay. Okay, great. So by default, if you don't specify any priority, that will be considered as a zero and it will execute
zero.
First. Okay.
Yes.
So what are the what is the use of annotations in TestNG?
It helps us to
what is the use of annotations?
Are,
yeah,
it helps to properly make the maintainable and make it ordered and reusable. We can use those parameters in XML document to execute.
Okay.
We can exclude cases. We can include cases like using groups where the groups tags.
Yeah, so basically annotations we use to control the order of execution.
Order.
Yeah, basically control the order of execution like before method, after method, right? And before
yes.
class and after class.
After class before the class. Yes.
Yeah. So what is the use of XML in TestNG? What is the main role of XML file in TestNG?
It helps us to run the particular, if we are going to run the class within the package like multiple classes, we can use the XML document to run, or in case of parallel testing to be done, we can use the XML documents. In order to pass the parameters also, we can use the XML documents. For grouping, we can use the XML documents like using the include and the exclude statements.
Okay. Okay.
Exclude
great.
Tags.
Okay, let's say I have a test case and XML file. I want to execute my test case using XML file. At the same time, I want to pass some parameters from XML file to the test method. So how we can pass
Unread parameters, or
okay.
I can use iTest context.
Okay, great. Okay, great. So, do you know about TestNG listeners?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, what is the use of TestNG listeners?
Like listeners are like something is according to their meaning. So, it listen the test cases. When it's going to fail, we can pass the value as failed. Or it is going to pass, we can pass the values as failed using the unread listeners in the particular class. Specifically in the class name, we can once the script executed properly, we can pass the listener value as the test is passed successfully or skipped successfully or failed successfully. So the listeners listens the test execution.
Okay, so that means TestNG listeners basically executes after completion of execution, like after test method passed or failed or skip whatever. So after that, TestNG listener methods will trigger. Like, can you just tell me what are the different methods are there in the TestNG listeners?
iTest listeners,
they are listeners, different type of listeners. So I'm asking inside those listeners, What are the methods are there? Listener methods.
Like skip, fail, pass. I think I'm not getting the name correctly. The entire method name.
Okay.
But on test pass, yeah. On test skips.
Okay. Okay. Great.
On test fail.
Yeah. On test success, on test failure, on test skip. So these are the different methods are there. Okay. Okay. So let me ask some questions from framework. You have involved in the framework, right? So you know how to start designing the framework from the scratch.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what is an object repository?
Object repository is it will have the entire elements using the page object model. It can capture the page web elements into the repository, which can be reusable for the entire for different test cases and scripts.
Okay. So how to implement page repository? So object repository.
Using the plain page object model, we can do it. Like, do you want to give the tag names or?
Okay, so basically, by using page object model, we can create page object repositories. Yeah, so basically, object repository means which is contains all the web elements, or repository means we can specify all the web elements into one location, which is basically called as a repository. So, object repository, because we put all the elements in one place. Okay, so what kind of framework you worked on?
Hybrid, like data driven and keyword driven.
Okay, so can you just explain what are the main components you have in your framework and how things will happen in your framework, how you generated the reports and all these things? Can you explain about that?
Yes, sir. Yeah. Actually, I use the programming languages Java, and in order to start any framework or execution, we need some prerequisites, like the data is going to be reusable data also, or prerequisite data also, like test data. Based on the framework, I'm going to create the form with the form model, page object models, which contains the object repository, like documents, like object repository values, classes.
Okay.
Will be present in the page object models. And under the configuration files, I may have the form.xml files, test.ng XML files, or some other log4j property file. Maybe I will put those in the configure files. And in utilities, I may have those Excel files, calling those the classes, which class to Excel file can be put into the utilities class files, or screenshots, or maybe the configuration files, the property file, configure property files can also be stored in the utilities. So once those values are properly arranged, we can get those value into the test cases, the next case. So using those values, we can again run the test cases, and using the framework TestNG automation framework, and under the Maven build, I used Maven build.
Okay.
So Maven build, actually the test for our project, the report is fine with the TestNG itself, as emailable report and index HTML report is fine for us. So we use it the browser. Also form.xml running through the form.xml file, in case something we are going to run a suit file, like from the start to the end, we use the form.xml file.
Okay, so yeah, that's fine, that's great. So what is basically form.xml contains?
Like it will suit tag names, like suits, tests, class, packages, class and methods. And you can also pass the parameter values. If you want to specify the parameter parallel testing, you can enable the values through.
No, I'm asking about Maven pom.xml file. I'm not asking about test.xml. Yeah. Pom.xml file from Maven. So what it contains?
It has plugins and dependencies, which is going to, because Maven is a project object model. So we have to have the dependencies of like Selenium, TestNG, JUnit, JXL, Apache PoE, and also source file plugin for running the compiling and running the test cases.
Okay, great. Okay, so, great. So how to run your pom.xml through command prompt?
Command prompt.
Yeah.
I've not done those.
Okay, so do you know any commands? Do you know any Maven commands?
Maven commands.
Yeah. Clean, test, run, or do you know something?
I've about clean. Clean I know. Build I know, but I just run it as a test in this so that you can be. There's a project manager. We use it as a build tool, so we don't go into much.
Okay, so what is the build tool? What is the build tool you have used?
Maven.
What is that?
Maven, sir.
Maven. Yeah, I'm asking the same thing actually. So pom.xml is actually related to Maven, right? So how we can execute the pom.xml? Because when you run your Maven project, the execution will start from pom.xml, right? So pom.xml contains all the configurations to run your project. So instead of running pom.xml directly, so how we can run pom.xml through command prompt?
I've not done that before, sir. I used to run the
pom.xml
directly through Maven build.
Okay, Maven build. Okay, no problem. So mvn clean test or install. So these commands you can use to run your project through command prompt. Okay, that's fine. Yeah, that's fine. Okay, and you mentioned like you also worked on JUnit in your framework. So do you see any differences between testing and JUnit?
Yes, sir. Instead of before method and after method, we'll use only before and after.
Okay, have you seen any additional advantages in TestNG when you compare with the JUnit?
Parameters cannot be passed in JUnit, I think.
Okay, okay.
It can be done in TestNG.
Okay.
Also, JUnit results are not ready. We have to integrate with Maven, hand tool to get the proper reports, because JUnit does not provide proper reports.
Okay.
TestNG is better than that in case of reporting.
Okay, okay. Yeah. Yeah, that's great, Manikandan. So I have done my side. So let me just give you the feedback. So whatever questions I have asked, you answered well, and almost Java and Selenium TestNG. So we have a good exposure. And the main area you need to focus and improve is coding part. Okay. So while asking some code, right, when you're writing your code, you are missing something like some syntactical error, some logic is missing there. So you need to more focus on that area. Okay. Other than that, theoretically, you are answering well and you know concepts well. But only thing is you need to have some more practical knowledge and you can just focus on that area. So other than that, you will perform. So with your experience, like 2 years experience, okay, that's fine. So answered well. And one more thing I can suggest you is whenever you answer something, just answer the questions in a clear manner. So you are in hurry and bury. I don't know exactly how you are feeling now. But when you're answering something, just have some clarity on that. You know the answer, but the way of presenting the answer is something, it's like a very faster way you are going. Okay, so just answer the question in detailed way, elaborate the answer, and step by step, go a little bit slowly. Okay, so that that will go very fine. Okay, don't be in hurry and bury. So whatever you know, or you can take the pen and paper also. Some questions, if you're not able to explain, right? So you can also take pen and paper and you can explain the answer. Okay, in that way, you can do it. Okay, that's all from my side. I think you have done well. Okay, that's all from my side. Okay, do you have any questions? Yeah.
Yeah, sir. Regarding Java, I'm not good at Java. I just know only the core Java concepts. So that's why the programming is something difficult. Just learned Java only for Selenium perspective, not to utilize in Selenium.
Okay.
So I don't have much.
So I can suggest you one thing actually. Even in the core Java also, you can improve the programming. Let's say you can work with the arrays concept or strings concept. You should be more familiar in these concepts, especially. You no need to learn like collections and lambda expressions, streams, all these things at the beginner level. You don't need these concepts. Like advanced Java means those concepts will come into picture. But initially, if you start career as an automation tester, right? So you don't need those concepts. Just basic with arrays concept, strings, right? These are very important thing. So whatever the programs I have asked in today's interview, so I just basically from Java strings and arrays concept. They are part of core Java, right? Some really basics.
Yes.
So you have to practice more coding examples related to string. Okay. You can practice more on string related programs or number related programs, array related programs. So if you do more example practice, and that is more than enough, you will be able to answer the coding related questions. And for that, you don't need to go in depth of Java. Okay. Yeah.
Okay,
so that's all. I'm just stopping here. So be prepared well and good luck and best of luck. Yeah, thanks for attending this.
Thanks a lot, sir.
Bye bye.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah,
bye, sir.